Hey there, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mitch, and welcome to April. Can you believe it? We're already 4 months into this YouTube challenge that I set for myself. Today, I have a question, and I also have the answer, but it's kind of complicated. That question is, why can't we divide by zero? First things first, we need to find out what a number is. A number is an arithmetical value expressed by a word, symbol, or figure, representing a particular quantity and used in counting and making calculations and for showing order in a series or for identification. That definition was from Oxford, and there's a lot of jargon in there. Essentially, it's just an entity between negative infinity and positive infinity that can be added, subtracted, multiplied, or divided to get another entity between negative infinity and positive infinity. So what's the problem? Doesn't that answer the question? Not really. I wish it was that simple.
All right, here's a cool idea. What if we ask the computer to do it? And by computer, I mean my most recently upgraded device that I have sitting under my desk. Why don't we just ask it how to divide by zero? I mean, computers have been around for so long. They would have to know. They would have to be able to do it at least, right?
All right, let's just create a new Java file. Let's just do a simple system.out.println 1 divided by 0.
What?
Hold on. Arithmetic exception. Dividing by 0.
What does that mean?
Look at this equation real fast. 3x equals 9. What's the value of x? Pretty simple. Just divide by 3 on both sides and you get x equals 3. Now look at this equation. 3 equals 9 over x. It's a little more to do, but it's pretty straightforward. Multiply by x on both sides and then divide by 3 again and you get x equals 3. Now look at this equation. 3x equals 0. What's the value of x? Well, all you have to do is just divide by 3 on both sides, and you get 0 over 3, which is 0. So x equals 0. Okay. Now bear with me here. One more equation. 0 equals 3 over x. What's the value of x? Should be pretty simple, right? Just multiply by x on both sides, and then divide by 0. And you get x equals 0, obviously. Or is it? In order to verify this, let's have a quick history lesson on zero in math.
In 628 AD, an Indian mathematician named Brahmagupta was the first to experiment with zero. In his treatise Brahmasutra Siddhanta, he argued that zero divided by zero is zero. His text is the earliest known example of giving a value to zero. This was revolutionary at the time. His argument for division by zero was rather unorthodox. Positive divided by a positive or a negative divided by a negative is positive. A zero divided by zero is zero. A positive divided by a negative is negative. A negative divided by a positive is also negative. A negative or a positive divided by zero that has zero in its divisor, or zero divided by a negative or a positive has that negative or positive as its divisor. The square of a negative or positive is positive. The square of zero is zero. That of which the square is its square root. Later, in 850 AD, another Indian mathematician, Mahavira, had something else to say. In his work, Ganita Sara Sangraha, he says something rather interesting about zero. A number remains unchanged when divided by zero. This effectively gives a value of nothing to zero. It's like if you tried to push a heavy box by looking at it, or taking paper notes in a class without a pencil. Nothing has changed about the box or the paper. Then, in 1150 AD, a third mathematician named Bhaskara II discussed the mathematics of zero. He posited in his work Lilavati that dividing by zero creates an infinite quotient. He believed that as the divisor becomes smaller and smaller, the quotient becomes larger and larger. So dividing by zero gives an infinitely large result. That raises another question. What about negative numbers? In his algebra treatise, Bijigonit, he acknowledged negative numbers and actually had modern ideas about them despite the time he was living in. The product or quotient of a debt and an asset is a debt. The product or quotient of two debts is an asset. debts were negative numbers and assets were positive numbers. Let's get closer to the modern day. In 1734, Irish philosopher George Berkeley criticized Newton and Leibniz's infinitesimal calculus and made one of the earliest recorded references to the modern mathematical impossibility of dividing by zero. Newton viewed quantities as changing over time. He introduced the concept of fluxions, instantaneous rates of change, and fluents, quantities that flow or accumulate. Calculus, for Newton, was built on motion and limits, but he didn't use the word limit in the modern sense. He worked with vanishing quantities. He let quantities tend to zero, but treated them as if they still had effect during computation. He would compute with these tiny quantities and then discard them, assuming it was fine to do so. Leibniz used a more algebraic, symbolic approach. He introduced dx and dy as infinitesimals, infinitely small quantities, but not zero. He treated them like algebraic terms, dy over dx equals derivative. No rigorous foundation, just a very useful notation system. The calculations worked, but what is an infinitesimal really? Berkeley criticized a lot of their calculus. Leibniz said, infinitesimals are neither something nor nothing. Ghostly. Berkeley said that infinitesimals were logically absurd. He also said that Newton's vanishing quantities were used inconsistently. Essentially, he said, you treat them as non-zero when calculating, then zero when you drop them. Which is it? And this final criticism was for all of calculus. Calculus lacks rigor. He called it fallacious reasoning and mathematical hocus-pocus. And thanks to Berkeley, math locked in and got a better grounded approach.
According to the rules of multiplicative inverses, if x equals 1 divided by 0, then x multiplied by 0 equals 1. But you never get a value for x unless you listen to Berkeley's explanation. Dividing by 0 is undefined. And because of Berkeley, the belief that zero is undefined is still in effect today, almost 300 years later.
Hello.
Allowing division by zero, technically, means assigning a value to zero. As just explained, this is inconsistent with all of our existing mathematical proofs. But what about nuclear fission?
When the first atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima in 1945, there was mass devastation to the Japanese population. If you were close enough to see the detonation, you likely would have experienced flash burns, ruptured eardrums, acute radiation syndrome, and post-traumatic stress disorder, just to name a few of the symptoms. Those closer weren't so lucky. Some were so close, near the epicenter, that they were vaporized. Their bodies were exposed to a temperature estimated to be 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit. They were disintegrated instantly.
The point of me bringing this up was to ask again, can you divide an entity by zero? The straightforward answer is yes, right? I mean, there were no remains found of those closest to the epicenter, so they must have been completely destroyed. Wait a minute. I feel like I'm violating a law of science, a law that governs our understanding of the universe, the law of conservation of energy. There it is. Science solved it. Matter cannot be created or destroyed. It only changes forms. It's a law that's been in effect for 236 years. So, when you divide by zero, you effectively attempt to destroy an entity, which is scientifically impossible. As for those lost in the bombings at Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they aren't gone in an atomic sense. They were vaporized, sure, but that word refers to a change to a state of matter, not a destruction of matter. This fact applies to our entire known history. It's the reason we can still dig up fossils of the dinosaurs. If we were to take the measure of the atoms at the beginning of the universe and the atoms at the end of the universe, they would be the exact same. It's a beautiful law of our reality that can be freeing, but also isolating. Nothing we do is truly lost, only muddied the waters of time. Well, I think that answers our question, ladies and gentlemen. Hello?
No, in the wrong direction on my street.
What's that?
I thought
I'd get 20 years ago. Veritasium made a new video about how energy isn't conserved in the universe?
Gotcha.
Imagine you're an astronaut out drifting in deep space. When you throw a rock as hard as you can, what's going to happen to that rock? Well, you would think that it would continue with constant velocity in a straight line. That's just Newton's first law. But what actually happens is it eventually slows down and stops. So why does this happen? Where did all the rock's energy go?
Well, shit.
Oh, hey there, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see, we're at the end of the video and I don't have a conclusion for you. I wish I did, but honestly, I don't think there's just one answer to this question. But thanks for watching anyway, and I hope you'll tune in next time. If you want a part 2 to this video, maybe I collab with Veritasium or something, comment down below. Maybe I can make it happen. Who am I kidding? Oh, sorry. All right, well, see you next time, guys.